Cool, whatever.
Awesome. Yep, let's get started. Hi everyone, I'm Rasagy. I'm here to talk about maps, data, and how to get data on maps or in maps. Just to kind of wake everybody up a bit and see whether everybody's actually listening to me, quick raise of hands, how many of you used a map to come to MLR convention? Great, so I think people are there in the last seat, you can see and hear me, people parking as well. Cool, second question, how many of you used a map to come to this auditorium? Not so many, huh? Like, few of us probably using the Hasgeek app to figure out how the venue is, but few of us already built a map in our head. So we had like a mental map of how this place is. Some of us are Hasgeek regulars, so they already know this place very well. The third question, which is obviously the start of the talk, is how many of you have used data and put them on a map to show in a visualization or in a project or in a dashboard? Awesome. Okay, great. So that means that a lot of you have already seen some of this stuff, which is great. A lot of you have been trying to do this stuff, which is also great. And some of you probably would be scared by some jargon, which hopefully by the end of the talk, you would not be scared of. So to quickly start off, I work at Mapbox. It's a platform for developers and designers to create basically different kind of stuff with maps. You would want to make visualizations, you would want to make a dashboard, you would want to make a tool which shows how delivery is happening, or if people here are using Snapchat, you want to use Snapchat and see where in the place are different people's photos, you would use Mapbox or a tool like Mapbox. So the way we like to call it, it's like a Lego building pieces, take different blocks, put them together and make what you want to make. So this is roughly what Mapbox is, and my work at Mapbox, I work as a designer, so my work is a lot in making custom maps. So we sit and refine details and details of what shows up on a map, and sometimes it leads to really good results. So if you would see, for example, the Fifth Elephant website, the map looks beautiful because it feels part of the whole website, has this nice steel color. So custom maps is fun, but this talk isn't so much about custom maps, it's much more on visualization. So the other kind of stuff that I tend to do is to see how you could use data and put that on a map and try and see if that gives a more insightful view than say making conventional charts like bar charts or pie charts if you're the kind. And I also try to play around with using maps as art. That's a separate topic. I spoke about it a while back on the telephone, but feel free to catch me if that's the kind of stuff you like to talk about as well. So let's get started. With all of the stuff that I keep doing, I tend to get two questions most often. The first question is what? Like, hey, I have this data, what can I do? Which essentially means, what are the different types of charts or visualizations that I can make with the kind of data that I have? Now, the common charts that we already know work very well, and there's so much written about it. There's also like a very seminal paper called A Tour of the Visualization Zoo. I'm hoping some of you have read it or heard about it. That's partially where the talk title is taken from, A Voyage into Geo-Visualization, inspired from Jeffrey Heer's seminal paper. But yeah, we all know about conventional charts, but some of us are not so familiar with what to do with a map, right? Or how to even approach that problem. So what can we do? And the second part, in case you've already figured out how you want to show your data, is to think about how do I do it well? Or maybe if I'm making, say, a choropleth or a cartogram, what do I keep in mind so that I can do this well? And that's roughly the two things that I'm going to talk about. A very quick list of things that I want to pick. So I don't want to jargon drop, but I want to use this as our itinerary for this talk today. So I'm going to go and keep checking one thing off our list and see how we're doing, right? So quickly start off, talk a bit about geo, about maps, about things that are there that you would want to put on a map, and then we move forward. Alright, so let's get started. This is a very typical map visualization. This shows basically like different bus stops that are there in Mumbai. Right? You probably would recognize the shape. What I want you to think about is the layers that are happening here. So currently that you can see, there are two major layers. There is this data of these nice firefly-like dots that have been shown on a map. And then there is the underlying data that's actually the map data, right? So there's a shape of Mumbai that you all can recognize. There is a label which tells you that it is Mumbai. There are these small airport symbols and there are roads, etc., etc. So for any visualization that I'm making, I need to think about two things. I need to think about the geo aspect, and by geo I mean what is the map, what does the map look like, where will the data go on top of, and second is the actual data. So that is your own data. You have like a CSV, a topo.json, a geo.json, or different sort of data sets that you already have, and how do I get that onto a map. So the reason I'm talking about this, and that's a very small segue that I want to do, is to just get everybody on the same page. And also like break these very obvious terms that people generally talk about in geo-visualization, which I think is very easy for all of us to know. So let's just quickly think about it. First, there are three types of things that you can make on a map or you can show on a map. They can be nodes, ways, relation, which are just fancy terms for saying dots, lines, or like squares or polygons, right? So you would have, say, places. For example, how many different MLR convention centers are there in Bangalore? Each will be represented as a dot, and that works pretty well. You would probably have lines. For example, what is the path to one MLR to another MLR? How is the traffic on top of it? Which one is an alternate route? All of those are lines. And then you would have polygons. For example, how big is the MLR convention? How much of that MLR convention is an auditorium? How much of that is a hall? And that would require you to use polygons. So roughly in this case, you can see that the dot on the top or the dot on counterculture is a node. The distance from the MLR convention to the nice Phoenix Mall is basically a route, so it's a line. And then you have an area of the mall that's mapped as a polygon. And that's roughly the technical stuff that you would want to know if you're doing anything on maps. The second thing that you want to do, which you were just talking about, is to pick a map to show data on, right? We generally, by default, use something like this, which is a very typical bright, nice colors, nice icons, lots of labels, a typical map, right? So this, if you're using Mapbox, is Mapbox Streets, is a similar sort of style that you would get in other tools that you're using as well. But it's always interesting to try and change this map itself. So if I'm going to show data on top of this map, I don't want to see the highway Hasgeek 275 stand out so much. Maybe I don't even want things to be in different colors so that I can use those colors on my map. So suddenly, we could tweak this by choosing a different base map, right? And this is a very small sort of segue which I want to do to just get that point across. That at times, you would want to compare and see how does the underlying map look like and does it help show my data well. So just to kind of throw some points on it and see the difference that on the first map style, which is the streets map style, you can start seeing that the data is visible, but kind of conflicts. There are so many other things that are catching for your attention. In the other two map styles, you suddenly start focusing your attention on the data that you want. And in a sense, in any good visualization, your first and primary goal is to make sure that the data is easily visible. So that was the introduction. Just to quick recap, you need to think about your base map and about the data before you get started. A quick segue also here on what could be there or what exactly is a map and a visualization and where do they kind of fuse in. So while we don't conventionally call it a visualization, seeing traffic on a map is itself a visualization. And that's something that we're already using very regularly. But it doesn't really feel the same as, say, conventional visualizations because it just feels part of the map. Suddenly, the roads that you already know have a color attached to them, and that color shows whether there's high traffic or low traffic. And that's an interesting sort of way to visualize data where it doesn't really stand out so much in your face as something that's been put on top of the map. Another very cool example that I love, which might not be very visible here, is to see Google Maps, and in Google Maps you can see some areas that get highlighted which have a lot of popular places in. So let me just try and see if I can get this here. If you notice, this is the 100 feet road, and you can start noticing that very subtle yellowish tinge that's been added to the map that makes you realize that okay, the part around the road here has a lot of interesting places whereas the rest of it doesn't. These are very subtle sort of visualization techniques that people do to add onto a map which doesn't feel suddenly like, oh, there's a big circle on a map, or there's a big shape on a map. And these are super interesting to kind of see. Sorry. Let's come back. So yeah, this technique is super subtle. You're basically tweaking the layers of a map. This is also a very niche technique, and for most of us sitting here, we don't really want to do this much. So we want to try doing something very, very basic. And by basic, I mean, let's start with the most basic thing. I have a bunch of dots which represent something. I want to put them on a map. So let's get started. I'll select a base map. In this case, I've selected this very light sort of map, so it doesn't really stand out too much. And I've added a bunch of things here. These are all the bus stops that are marked on OpenStreetMap for Bangalore, right? And you can start seeing this. It looks okay. There's too many blobs. There's places where they're getting overlapped. And while we're getting all the attention to the data, I think it's getting too much of attention, right? So quickly changing things and playing around with some visual properties like opacity. Reduce opacity, and this slightly gets a bit blurry, but also starts highlighting some interesting parts of the data. So you can start seeing some clusters around a particular set of roads which start making this more interesting. Let's take this further. We could use color to try and show some other property of data. So in this case, I might want to say, out of the bus stops that are marked on OpenStreetMap, which of these seem to have some sort of a wheelchair attribute? Are they wheelchair friendly? Are they not friendly? Is there any data about it? Suddenly, I can start using color to make some of these dots pop up. And next, I can start using size as well, right? So now suddenly I can add a few more properties and start changing dots to start looking bigger or smaller based on which one is important or which one is the data that I want to stand out the most. And in essence, what we just did, for folks who've already been doing visualization for a while or have been reading some really good text, is essentially just picking visual encoding different variables and just applying them in the map style, right? So for those who aren't used to this, there's a lot of literature written about what are the different ways in which I could take a particular sort of form on a map and let data denote, you know, different things on it. So you could change color, you could change size, you could change direction, etc., etc., etc. So feel free to kind of look this up. There are a lot of different people who have given different sort of explanations to it. But before we move forward, I want to do just one small sort of mention here about how this is separate. So when we have our data, for those who already have been using a lot of data sets, there's a very clear difference between the data that is continuous, so it might be numbers, or data that is categorical, which could be discrete values. So for example, in this case, you can see that if your data is, say, how many buses go on each bus stop, that's a number that changes from 0 to maybe 10 or 100, and you might want to use a gradual scale for it. Whereas if you have something that is each point being each quality of data or each type of data, for example, what are the different types of, let's say we want to represent different types of facilities available at different bus stops, right? So there isn't an inherent numerical order in them, and there's no inherent quantitative order in them. And that's the place where you would want to use the first section, where you identify them with colors, maybe which have different hues and stuff like that. So just like, I want to get some of these very basic stuff out of the window so that now we all feel on the same page to get started talking about some real map visualizations. So here are some examples. This one is a fun map. There's a bunch of folks who went around asking a bunch of folks in America, here's a map, can you tell me where Ukraine is, right? And I'm not sure how many of you, I probably shouldn't have told this before, but I wonder how many of us could also mark where Ukraine is. So in this case, every dot is a guess. They've used color to kind of show how close your guess is to actual Ukraine location, and they've used opacity to suddenly highlight where people think, you know, where people think Ukraine is versus where it, you know, actually is. So it's a fun way to get started with something as simple as putting dots on a map. Here's another really interesting case. In this case, they're showing earthquake data over the years. They're using very subtle techniques of time as well as opacity. And there's also this fun symbols thrown in. So suddenly there is a triangle which represents volcanic eruptions, and then there are these two different colors up which are being used. And suddenly we start seeing some really interesting use of something as basic as putting dots on a map, right? And this gets really interesting. You can make this interactive and you can start doing some really cool stuff with it. You can also create some really controversial pieces with this. For example, this is a racial segregation in New York and neighborhood areas where each dot is colored based on what is the common sort of race that stays there. And these become really interesting to show the detail in the data that you have on a map that we all are so familiar with. But there are times when you would want to highlight insights. And it's time like these where you would want to use, say, the size a lot. In this case, this is a visualization over time where you're showing how many jobs were lost or gained. The color is denoting that and the total number is showing the impact, right? And you can start seeing in the initial part the bubble burst, the dot-com bubble that burst, and then the recession that came in. And these, and this is like a graduated proportional symbol map if you enter the technical names, but there are these techniques and they very quickly hit a sort of a wall, right? And this is like a very fun thing. This is essentially all the potholes that are there in New Jersey. And while the intention is really great, it doesn't really communicate much. And what's happening is that we start plotting individual points on a map. There's only so many points that we can put. And after a while, we'll really hit a limit as to what data can be shown. And like, this is a cue for all the folks who are in big data or like huge amount of data saying, yes, this doesn't work, maps are useless, let's throw them out and let's use big data for something else. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. So a very easy way, the first obvious solution to this problem is to cluster, right? So we still have the dots, we still show individual dots on a map, but if there are too many of them nearby, we cluster them and make a bigger dot. Right? And we can change the clustering based on the size, the type, and also add some subtle effects. Like over here, you have some color that's been added to highlight more and less. And this is basically the women march that happened a few months back. Not trying to be political here, but this is a great example of what you could do with this. So essentially, with dots, it's really interesting if you keep in mind the different visual encoding principles that you have. And it's super important for us to make sure we control the density. So suddenly, if there are too many of these, we want to figure out something else. And apart from clustering, second something else that we are all very familiar with is choropleth, often called chloropleth, but it has nothing to do with chloro in it. But what we're going to do here is something very simple. Instead of showing individual dots, let's count how many dots appear in an area that we are all very familiar with. So, different states of US, we all know how they look like. Let's count how many are in one and just show the data, right? So, suddenly now, it becomes very easy to show a summary of the data that you have in shapes that you recognize. So, this is one example where you're using light to dark color to kind of denote the sort of density or how much amount is there. This is a pretty good chart by Quartz. Whereas this is another example by Mike Bostock, where he's using two things very subtly, changing the hue a little bit and mostly changing the brightness, right? And this is like a third example. And in this example versus in this example, you can start seeing that there is a change in how the story is being told. This is going from light to dark, so the darkness really stands out. Whereas in this case, both the edge points really stand out. So this is a good example of how you would want to use color in a choropleth map and trying to see if you want to make a diverging scale, whereas there's something that is showing the positive or the negative part of your data and highlighting that much more than the average data, or you would want to just use a single sort of scale that shows the edges or the maximum of the data set, right? So just quickly running through this part, but that's essentially what choropleth would be, right? They would give you your familiarity, but the only problem here is that the data isn't always based on the area, right? So for example, in this case, or let's take the first case, each state is being colored, but we still don't know where exactly or how much of that state actually has humans to begin with. Right? And this leads to these really fun visualizations where people say, oh, the places which tend to have a lot of McDonald's also tend to have a lot of car accidents. So you should shut McDonald's so that there are less car accidents. But the truth there is that more places with high population will have more McDonald's, and more McDonald's have nothing to do with more car accidents. It's the same thing, population and population. So a similar sort of question always comes up when you do choropleths, right? And a quick way to change that is to split the whole map in two small things that you would want to call pins. So I'm going to quickly move through some of these examples just to get the point across about how diverse the map visualization scene is and where you would want to pick which one to get started with. So here is an example of hex pins. So essentially breaking the map into hexagonal shapes and then counting the number of or the point of data or highlighting the data that you want to highlight. So this is no longer too dense with too many points. It's no longer too abstract or very, very high level like choropleth. It's somewhere in the middle. Each hex bin is equal sized. So it gives you a better perspective of how the data is distributed and makes things really interesting. So there's a really lovely journalism piece on Germany and how Germany, even though the wall between East and West Germany broke down, still very segregated in different sort of attributes. But what's really interesting is that they're using these very nice circle pins here. So break Germany into small pieces, all of equal size, count the data that you want to show, and then show it using color. And this becomes really interesting to see this slight sort of segregation, the sort of patterns that really show up. So in a sense, if you're using pins, it's a great idea because it's the best of choropleths as well as say clustering or dot plots, and becomes really interesting to use it to also get some sort of insightful data. But let's move forward and go into these really wacky map visualizations as well. And these are the parts where things get really interesting, especially if you're doing data which has some real big impact. This is the map of the world. And that's interesting because it feels familiar, but it has some really weird skewing going around. And that's roughly what a cartogram generally is. A cartogram is going to take a familiar geographical area and going to skew it, move it, tweak it around based on a property that more truly reflects what you want to see. So in this case, you're seeing population being used as a data to skew the countries. So no longer do you see, say, Europe standing out as much as it does, but India suddenly and China become these huge mammoth blobs on the map, right? Here's another sort of example which I really like because it shows this interactively and really gets the point across. So if you see the top, I'm just switching between different data fields and the map is slowly moving to highlight the sort of view of the world based on that. And this is a very interesting technique. It really breaks the sort of biases that we might have which are coming in because of how a map looks like. So suddenly, just because there is a huge state doesn't mean that it has as many people. And density of people or your own data properties starts becoming much more useful and easier to reflect. And here's another technique. So in this technique, what we were doing, we were taking a geographical area that we are used to seeing and tweaking it around. The second technique, on the other hand, makes a shape for each of the geographical area, represents them in a form that we are very comfortable with, and then moves it around. So it becomes slightly more abstract. This is called the Dorling's cartogram. This is an example from Mike Bostock's Protovis time. But it's super interesting because it illustrates two things. It illustrates how obesity has increased over time in USA, and the color kind of gives the density, or like how much, not the density, but the percentage of people in each state and how much obese they are. So this is going a bit on the abstract side. So suddenly we are not using the map as we see the map, but we're using an abstract representation of the map to start visualizing data. And there's another sort of very interesting piece. And if you're interested in cartograms in general, the best idea is to look at a lot of journalism websites because they deal with these sort of issues the most, where you're seeing a shape of a country, of a state, which you're very used to seeing, but you're changing the data to actually reflect the story that you're showing. So here's a square cartogram which changes the size based on how many policies are there, and it uses color to kind of identify, okay, is this the state that has said yes, is this the state that is still thinking about it, or is this the state that has said no? And here's like another interactive sort of switch between making like a traditional choropleth to making a cartogram. And I think this is a good example to highlight. So this is UK, and you can see London, which is way below gets highlighted more prominently, and some parts of the map which are generally less populous are reduced in size. So this is a fun technique to try out. I would love to have conversations later on how to make these, or what exactly has been a problem that you've been trying to solve with this. But there's another technique, and I'm just here to talk about different techniques so that we all have different fodders to think about the next time we're doing something. And this technique is called tile grids. So in the previous one, we were changing the shapes or the sizes of different parts of the map based on the data. In this one, we represent each and every shape in a single equally sized entity. And this becomes more interesting if your data set is something that is equally important for each state, right? So it doesn't depend on population, it definitely does not depend on geographical area, but it just depends on the number of each state. So if we suddenly start talking, for example, how much percentage of our budget goes in each state in different countries, in USA or India, you don't care whether the state is huge or not. You're first interested in seeing the percentage. Maybe you want to do a per capita, which kind of removes the population at all and gives you a better picture. So in cases like this, a tiled grid map becomes really interesting and becomes even more interesting if you use something called small multiples. So for folks who are very used to data visualization, small multiples is a very familiar term. Make a chart, repeat it, and change the data to show seasonality or see the change over time, right? And so tile grids, because they've suddenly become very abstract and easy to show in a very small space, make for great contenders to do small multiples. So this is a great example of showing the similar data of the base city, but now showing it in a single view instead of using, say, a timeline to move through it. So that was cartogram. Cartogram is slightly complicated to create. You can use tools which are, say, GIS specific, or you can write a bit of code and then try and create this. But they are much more honest, they are much more closer to the data that we want to show. And the last few that I want to quickly talk about, and then maybe, I know some people are also getting slightly hungry, and there have been three data viz talks which have kind of eating up all your brain. So I'll quickly go through these, not take too much time on this. So heat maps, very familiar, we've all seen, say, weather being shown as heat maps or a different sort of variable. So I'm going to show the Snapchat example. So I'm hoping some of you have Snapchat and seen this, but if you have not seen this, what this is essentially doing is finding clusters where people are all posting photographs of Snapchat publicly and showing a heat map. So suddenly a heat map is no longer just a data visualization technique. It's also a great technique to nudge people to explore different parts of your data. And this becomes really interesting in some really interactive use cases, one of them being Snapchat. So essentially, if you're making heat maps, it's going to be great if you're going to do like a high level overview, and it's the only caveat there is to choose your colors wisely. So in this case, you can notice that the color palette goes from a light color palette to a dark color palette, even though it's still very rainbowish. And that's just something that we can, again, talk a bit more about in the OTR session if you want to talk about, or maybe catch me after the talk. On how do you pick colors well, because colors itself, even though we think red, green and blue feel like a natural progression, have different hue and different sort of brightness and saturation that goes around. It's interesting to see how you would want to use this. And last two very easy examples also to talk about, isopleths. That's a very scary name, and they have like many more variations like isochrone and isobars, etc., etc. But they're essentially using lines to mark data as boundaries, right? And here is like a very easy to see example. So from MLR convention in Bangalore, where can I go to different parts of Bangalore over different amount of time, right? So while we're very used to seeing point to point data temporally, saying from place A to place B, this is the amount of time it will take. Suddenly we start putting temporal or like time related data on top of a map and start seeing, huh, this is interesting. There's some part of an infrastructure that's really limiting people to go into one direction. And maybe that's a great example for somebody in infrastructure to understand. Or maybe it's just easier for us to understand, hey, next time we are hosting Fifth Elephant, what is the most accessible place which reaches to most people in Bangalore? So, isochrones are super interesting. slightly complicated to make because they're essentially going to use a lot of data. In this case, you would want to use some sort of a direction or navigation data set that's going to tell you, okay, this to this, so this to this is going to be this much time, but it's super interesting to get the insights out of it. And I know now is going to be like a better trigger for people to slowly move out, but before that, let's quickly finish two more things. So flow maps have been one of the more commonly used map techniques back in the days, before you had interactivity, before you had all of these fancy tools that we have. And this is one of the many interesting flow maps that you can see. These become much more interesting when you have connectivity or connections in your data. This today is slightly more complex to represent, and you need to mold your data to get easily like make such maps. They're also very interesting to tell stories. So some of my favorite stories which I've seen in journalism have come out with people using flow or showing flow from one place to another to tell insights. So in this case, for example, if you can see the arrows, this shows where people or where students from each state in USA go to another state to attend public schools. And that makes this very interesting sort of conversation that none of the other sort of map visualization techniques would be able to convey so successfully or easily. So to like wrap this up, flow maps are essentially connections. They're really useful to do storytelling and build narratives around. And last and not the least, because this is something that people love and hate, is 3D. So I'm gonna just wrap this up by talking about two very interesting examples of what we would do when you have 3D stuff on a map. So this is the first example. This is Vancouver, and the government there is trying to see how is our area basically divided in different zones based on different types of usage of the building area. But it's interesting here to see the data not just in a 2D view but also in a 3D view, because you get like a better perspective of, okay, this is actually how the city is. Most of these areas have these really small, really low height buildings, whereas that's the main downtown area, and the downtown area has been dedicatedly kind of zoned in to have these sort of types of buildings, right? So this is an interesting use case where you would want to use 3D. You want to show the real world as close to possible, and then you would want to use a common technique. So in this case, this is essentially a sort of choropleth you make, but you've just used a 3D element to it to make it interesting. The other reason to use 3D is to actually make good use of the third dimension. So suddenly, instead of just showing a two-dimension map which shows one data property, you can start using two dimension on the map. So there'll be, say, color. In this case, there's also height and there's also volume, right? So you suddenly start using 3D as a nice venue to show more sort of insightful data queries that you might not be able to make if you're seeing a 2D map. So in this case, the bar's height shows the population density in each of the small building. But because it's a 3D representation, you can also see how much volume is there, which essentially is the number of people staying there, right? So suddenly you can start making a difference between, okay, this part is really thin but really tall. And that means that a lot of people are trying to stay in this really small area, and that stands out a lot. So if you notice some parts in slightly south of San Francisco, you'll notice these sort of anomalies. And these are some of the good examples or use cases where you would want to try and use 3D. In all other cases, 3D is generally a gimmick. And as many other data viz guys would say, before you're using 3D, think, do you really need to use 3D? Right. So that's, I know this is like a very heavy load of suddenly like a textbookish or like, oh my god, 10 different ways to visualize data on a map. But the idea or the goal being, hey, these are the things that you could do. And before we wrap up, I just want to mention very quickly the tools that you would want to use. I am a designer, so I don't write as much code as I would like to. But I know a lot of people here love to do that. So this is something that we can have a longer discussion in the OTR session. But just to very quickly summarize, there are interactive tools. there are tools that you would not want to write code in. So there's Tableau, which is really great, drag and drop, and you get your data loaded and it's up and ready for you to start visualizing. There is Mapbox Studio, which is what I've been using to make all these custom maps. It'll give you much more control over each and every element of the map, and then you can overlay data on top of it. And then there's also other tools like Carto, which also do a lot of interesting sort of data visualization by drag drop or very seamlessly making map styles. Then there are these slightly more things, maybe things that we are more familiar with. So familiar name being D3, Mapbox as a WebGL, it's graphical library, Mapbox.gl. There's also Uber, the guys are outside, so you should probably chat with them. And there's DeckGL. And then there are these GIS tools. So I want to wrap up with this very interesting and like slightly tongue-in-cheek quote, which says that nothing is certain in this life but death, taxes, and requests for geographic data to be put on a map. So with that, that's me, Rasagy. Thank you so much. Do we have time for questions? Cool, so we could take some questions now, or otherwise you can all come over for the OTR session where Anand, Amit and I will be hanging around as well. Anybody has any questions? Or do we all just follow the crowd?
Everybody wants a tea break. We'll be back in here at 11:50. And at noon, we have an OTR on financial data analysis.